I guess I got my voice warmed up so I can start. I'm not going to talk too long. It's all been said. But I am going to leave you with one thought. Eternity is dependent on our free will to reap the most of it. God left it up to us to do our utmost for his highest. I'm going to look at, we're not going to read every verse. It's a very short book. Philemon. I'm going to read a couple of verses out of the book of Philemon. Philemon's a leadership epistle. We've heard a lot about leadership too. We lead at least ourselves. And every time we walk with God, we're going to lead other people. I took a hike yesterday with Mike Conkin and his two sons and Matt and Eric. That's one of the places I love to learn from God and God's Wilderness University. And he's got a lot to teach. Not everybody appreciates that. Some people like other things. But I appreciate that. And whenever I get into God's Wilderness University, things kind of gel. But you got to recognize free will because God does. He started off with Adam and Eve. He gave them one commandment, one thing not to do, and they, by golly, they figured out how to do that. But you know what God didn't do? He didn't try to stop them. He didn't say, stop! That's the thing right there. Stop. Stop what you're doing. That's what I was talking about. Because had he done that, would he be our loving Heavenly Father? No. He'd be an ogre. He'd be a dictator. He'd be a tyrant. And God's none of those things. He's a loving daddy. So I love this love epistle of Philemon. You know, Jesus Christ is the subject of every book of the Bible, and in Philemon, he's the love of a believer. And one of the things that is brought out in brilliant detail in Philemon, read it for yourself sometime, is the sanctity of free will and the privilege we have to utilize that free will in whatever way we choose. And when we utilize it for God's purposes, oh, look out for the fireworks because they're coming, like we've heard so many testimonies of, so much information about just this morning. Paul witnessed a run, and because he came to Rome where Paul, and he sent that runaway slave back to where he ran away from. And like Kevin had pointed out last night, we can be bitter. We can feel justified with our blame. But encourage Philemon not to do that. And Paul said in verse 8, of Philemon, wherefore, though I might be much bold in Christ to enjoin or order thee that which is convenient or appropriate. Did Paul have the authority? Yeah, he was an apostle. He was a teacher. He was a preacher. He was ordained a lot of things. Who ordained him? God did. So God gave him all that authority. But look what he says. I could order you to do this. To do what's right. Verse 9, yet for love's sake. That's why it's the epistle about the love of a believer. And this is how leadership needs to work too. Yet for love's sake, I rather beseech you, I rather lovingly beg you to do what's right. And that's how God encourages us. We've been encouraged throughout this entire time frame to do the will of God. And when we do, we get rewarded for all starts with an E, eternity. For love's sake, I rather beseech you, lovingly implore you, being such an one as Paul the aged, now also a prisoner of Jesus Christ. Paul wanted to retain him with him, but he sent him back to Philemon, verse 14, but without thy mind, thy opinion, thy focused perception, without thy mind would I do nothing, that thy benefit should not be, as it were, of necessity, but willingly. God doesn't force us to earn eternal rewards, but he makes them readily available for us to do so. Without our mind, he wouldn't do anything. Without our free will decision. So we have free will decisions aplenty to make in the rest of our lives. So we can make them with and for God, with and for our Lord Jesus Christ, in the purposeful, godly direction whenever we choose to. The loving direction whenever we choose to. Isn't that freedom? And I love you very much. I love how each individual here has contributed to the mutual believing so that we could have what we have. You know, the audience, the listeners shape every teaching by their mutual believing or the lack thereof. And I have not been stymied one syllable throughout this weekend. I love you. God bless.
So, true confessions. There's always the teaching you plan to teach, the teaching you teach, and the teaching you want to teach. And I sat down and I went, because I forgot to make a point. So, God's good. I get to make it now. I think I talked about how God purposed each one of us. Along with that goes the mutual respect of one another, because we are around people that have been dreamed of. And I think this weekend was a great example of that. Just our backgrounds, I mean, we're just a unique bunch of people. We don't all come at things the same way. We've gotten to learn from each other. And it's been very tender and very respectful and very sweet. And that is what God would have us do. Amen. So it's been a privilege to be a part of this. And it's been a lot of fun. So God bless you.
Thanks to everybody for all that you've done. There's always a lot of thankfulness going around. And wanted to include the folks that dealt with all the food, and the setup people, and the backstage people, and the physicals, and all the other folks we're forgetting. But congratulations to all of you, because you are living God's plan for your life. There's a temptation as I go around some places, there's a temptation to think, you know, to quote a verse like Jeremiah 29:11 that the evangelical world loves so much, and to think about God's plan for their life in the sense of waiting for it to kick in here soon. And pretty soon you're 65 and 70, and one of these days God's plan for my life is going to get started, and I am so excited. Well, the fact that you're here, you've been living God's plan for your life. His primary plan for your life, as we read in Romans 8, is that before the foundation of the world, you were called to be conformed to the image of his Son. That's his plan for your life. To walk by the Spirit is his plan for your life. To live a prophetic life is his plan for your life. To be empowered as a healer and as a blesser of God's people, that's his primary plan for your life. To walk in the fruit of the Spirit is his plan for your life. You are living God's plan for your life now, and you have been, he will occasionally download specifics along the way. But don't wait for an Excel spreadsheet. Don't wait for a guy with long blonde hair and no shirt on a white horse to blow in with God's plan for your life. That was for the ladies, by the way. But congratulations to you, because many of us in this room, this outdoor room, many years ago began investing and sacrificing and planting. You've invested for years and years so that when you got into the later years of your life, you would be able to continue faithfully preaching, teaching, healing, ministering, encouraging, being merciful, being kind. You invested, you prepared, you planned, you were trained, you learned, you studied, you course corrected, you were reproved and corrected, and you grew, and all of it, you had a vision for the future so that you would faithfully continue to be in the will of God, and you pictured yourself aging in him, and you pictured yourself fulfilling your ministries in him, and you pictured yourself having the fire of the Holy Spirit overflowing in your life decade after decade after decade. Congratulations, because you are here in those very days that you prayed for as a young believer. You are here. This is what you prayed for. Congratulations. And it's unusual, and it's hard, it's unpredictable, and you can't control every aspect of it, but that's called a walk by the Spirit. You're living God's plan for your life. You're a full-time minister. You began as a full-time minister the moment you accepted Christ as Lord. You began a life of service, a dedicated life of service. The place was shaken where we were assembled this weekend. You can never say that I don't know what that's like. If you were listening, if you were watching God move and his Spirit move, you have experienced a weekend where the place was shaken where they were assembled. Its hearts moved, its bodies healed, its discoveries, its... we say cross-pollinating. It's iron sharpening iron, and you're willing to move ahead. And we've touched the hem of his garment this weekend. And I guess that's the exhortation that I think about, like from Timothy, where Timothy received a letter from Paul, and Paul said, I thank Christ Jesus, my Lord, for counting me faithful, for putting me into the ministry, he said in 1 Timothy. And that's the best translation of that. Paul said, I thank Christ Jesus, my Lord, for counting me faithful and putting me into the ministry. Faithfulness is not just a repetition of doing the same thing every day forever, going to the same rotary meeting every day forever. You know, it's not about repetition and grinding it out to repeat what you did yesterday. That's not that God's definition of faithfulness is more about trusting him each day. It's about what does he want from me today? And then what does he want from me today? And then what does he want from me today? And as you look back on it, it won't be a repetition, repetition, repetition. It'll be in his will, in his will, in his will. And the days will look very different. So thank you for inviting us, Ed. And we love being here. And so big hugs all around. We'll take your love back to where we are. Please come see us. But keep touching the hem of his garment. Keep reaching out, pushing through the throng, the crowd, to touch that hem. Because when you feel like you're at the end of your rope, that rope better be coming from the hem of his garment. Okay? Sarah.
If you are able, I would like you to stand, please. And then, if you would like to close your eyes and lift your hands, I'm going to read some words, and then we're going to sing a song. And when we sing the song, it's on your song sheet. We're going to do verses 1, 3, and 4, but lift your hands and listen to these words right now, please. See if you recognize it, written by someone who was in the body of Christ. We're going to see him again. And we recognize people who have gone before us, that because of their desire in 300 AD, we have what we have today, and though we don't even know it. O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. And that's the song we're going to sing.
O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the
just want to let you know, Sharon has just been tirelessly planning, housing, food, communicating with people, and I just wanted to acknowledge that before you. She's an amazing woman of God. She's an incredible wife to me, and it's a just great honor for us to serve together for the last 19 years as husband and wife. And I just wanted to give Sharon a hand, please.
You guys are awesome. Thank you. You know, it's been a lot of work, but it's joyful work, you know, and you just go with it. And it's just been wonderful to see all you guys, some of new people I've met, and it's a pleasure to do this. You know, we've never done anything like this before, but it's a learning thing, and it's been wonderful to have all you guys here. And yeah, so till the next time, we'll see you later.
Thanks so much, honey.